When it comes to the strength of your 3D printed parts, print settings play, besides the material, a major role in what your prints can handle. Unfortunately, I hear and read way too often that many only adjust the infill ratio to adjust that property. For this reason, I tested the strength of different infill patterns on tons of these hooks and, more importantly, show how you should really strengthen your parts. Guten Tag everybody, I'm Stefan and welcome to CNC Kitchen. If you have your material dialed in, you will usually only adjust a small number of settings before each print, depending on the requirements of your part. If you want it to be strong, many will only adjust the infill density to a higher value. This will scale the infill pattern density and defines how much of the internal cavity is filled with material, which can go up to even a fully dense part. The other option is increasing the thickness of the outer shell by adjusting the shell thickness, wall thickness, number of perimeters, or however it is called in your slicer. Usually for a strong print, you'll be adjusting both values. But what really gives you the strongest result and which is the most economical way, meaning how can you increase the strength of your part with the least amount of material? If you want to print lightweight structures, this is something which is really important. In order to properly answer these questions, I printed quite a lot of these trusty test hooks and measured their strength. For science. This is definitely not perfect and doesn't include all possible load cases and orientations, but I still think this is a good real-world example and probably one of the best analyses you'll find at the moment. The reason why I use my hook from my filament test series for the investigation instead of standardized axial test specimens is that the critical area is loaded with a more everyday load case. Since the location of load application is a little offset, the lever arm will cause an additional bending moment that is superposed with the axial force. In real life, your part will also be mostly be loaded by such a combination, so the result I present, even though not 100% scientific, will probably be more usable and prove my point better. As a first investigation, I wanted to find out what difference the infill patterns make on the strength of the part and print time. I also wanted to find out if 30% infill really meant that 30% of the internal volume was filled by material. Since I used Simplify 3D as a slicer for these tests, I was trying out the following available patterns. Rectilinear, grid, triangular, wiggle, fast honeycomb and full honeycomb. Rectilinear is usually the default and prints the fastest, whereas wiggle is probably more for aesthetic purposes. Like for most of my parts, these hooks were printed with only 2 perimeters and 4 bottom and 5 top layers at 0.2mm layer height. All the parts were printed in polylite PLA by the way. Print time for the rectilinear infill was the shortest with only 48.5 minutes. Grid infill took 50.5 minutes and triangular 53. The patterns with lots of directional changes took the longest with 55 minutes for the full honeycomb. And interestingly, wiggle and fast honeycomb took the longest, needing 56.5 minutes. This is not fully representative, since the time changes due to the geometry and ratio between outer walls and infill, but shows that you can definitely save some time using the standard rectilinear infill pattern. Taking a look at the real final weight of the parts was pretty interesting, because most of the hooks weighed around the same, resulting in a calculated infill of roughly 33%. Only the hook with the triangular pattern weighed quite a bit more and ended up with a 45% infill instead of the assigned 30%. But now to the most interesting part. What was the strength of the parts? As expected, wiggle did the worst with only 45 kilograms until failure. Rectilinear came next and failed at 48 kilograms. Then there was grid with 52 kilograms and both honeycomb patterns failed at 57 kilograms. The hook with the triangular infill was the strongest, failing at 60 kilograms. But as we have seen before, 30% infill in your slicing software doesn't necessarily mean 30% material in the infill. For this reason, let's take a look at which infill is the most economic. So, where do we get the most strength per weight? This is where you see that the triangular infill is no more the best, but both honeycomb infill score the highest values. The order of the rest stays pretty much the same. In the first analysis, we have seen that the full honeycomb seemed to be the most economic solution if you want to increase strength. As a next test, I wanted to find out how the strength of the hook changes depending on the different infill ratios from 0 to 100%. I did the analysis with the full honeycomb infill but also the rectal linear because I wanted to know how my standard infill pattern behaves with different infill ratios. Even though it seemed with the first tests that the honeycomb pattern was significantly stronger than the standard infill, taking a look at all the values between 15 and 75%, they are pretty much the same. The interesting part again is if we take a look at the print time, where the rectilinear pattern starts to shine. At smaller infill ratios, both infills give you around the same strength in the same amount of print time. But as soon as you go over 50%, the rectilinear prints way faster than a honeycomb at the same strength. But wait, this is not the end. Let me show you how you can really increase the strength of your part the right way, without worrying about infill ratios and infill patterns. I hope this analysis is not too technical, but I think there's too much superficial knowledge around about this topic, so I thought I'd approach it at least a little scientific. If you would like to see more in this direction, please let me know in the comments and consider becoming a Patreon. This doesn't only help me spend more time on these topics, but you'll also get access to all of the detailed test reports and the test models. Alright, so I have already said in the beginning, the critical section of our hook is not only loaded in tension, but also in bending. If you bend a part, just like the piece of foam right here, one side will be stretched, the other side compressed. The part in the middle is not stretched at all, so the material which is placed in the core of our part usually is not loaded at all or only slightly. The further material is next to the outer shell, the more it contributes to the strength and the stiffness of the part. Which thickness we can adjust with a number of perimeters, shells, wall thickness or similar. In order to find out how this affects the strength of our hooks, I printed more samples with 2 to 6 shells and only a moderate 15% infill. I also increased the number of top and bottom layers to get a constant wall thickness of my part. If we take a look at the results, we can directly see that increasing the shell thickness is way more efficient than varying the infill. At the same weight, a hook that was reinforced with more shells is significantly lighter than a hook where only the infill was increased. What's also interesting is that a hook with 6 perimeters is already as strong as a part with 2 perimeters and 100% infill. This is due to the reason that in this case, the strands of filament of the shell are in the direction of the internal forces, so in their strongest orientation, making them way stronger than the infill that is rotated all the time. For completeness, let's also take a look at the print times, and here we see that in my case, I didn't save print time with the perimeter method. Print times at the same strength were very comparable to the hooks where the infill was varied. The reason for this is that the outer shell is usually printed slower and with lower accelerations than the infill to improve print quality. Okay, so what's my verdict? If you want to print stronger parts, increase the number of perimeters and top and bottom layers. Don't only crank up the infill ratio. I wouldn't usually use infill ratios of 100% because at first it's not economic and second might lead to severe printing problems if only a small amount of overextrusion is happening. Also, don't try to get 100% infill with increasing the wall thickness all the way because that also can lead to printing problems and, as I have told you before, material in the core mostly doesn't contribute a lot to the strength of your prints. For parts that need to be strong, I usually don't go above 4 perimeters and 50% infill. That is a good compromise between material usage and strength. Even though rectilinear infill wasn't always the strongest, I'm still a huge fan of this pattern because it gives you quite a dense grit even with low infill ratios, which is good for your top layers. I might need to try out the 3D infill patterns that are available in Slick 3R and Cura and find out how they fare, also considering loads in different directions. But what's your approach at the moment if you want to print parts that need to handle some beating? Let me know down in the comments.
I hope I was able to clarify and debunk some myths about infill and part strength. If you liked the video and learned something, then please hit the like button, share and subscribe. If you want to support my work and research, consider supporting me on Patreon. Thanks for watching, auf Wiedersehen, and I'll see you next time.